5 years.
We have come here for worship, to restore our sins to us for all, and to stand in our perspective.
Too easily we lose our way. So we gather to restore, expand, and grasp anew what we have forgotten.
We celebrate the rich heritage we have been given, and see in him our brighter future.
We all lift our voices to praise God.
time to time, the congregation designates an elder to be elder emeritus as a way of giving special recognition to an individual or individuals who has made extraordinary contributions to the life of the church through his or her many years of faithful and loving service to Jesus Christ and the church. This year, the congregation recognized and honored Lillian and Lyle Fry as elder emeritus. We as a congregation wish to thank you for your many years of faithful shepherding and your dedication to the Word of God and the teaching of Jesus Christ. And most of all, for what you have both meant and continue to mean to the life of this church.
So what are we celebrating today?
The anniversary of the church.
The 75th anniversary of the church. Why are we celebrating that?
Because it's a very important time, and it means that we have been in the church for about 75 years.
Very true. We've lasted 75 years as a church, and that's very, very good. But I want to give you some other examples of why I think we're celebrating today. What's one of the main goals of a church? To honor God, to learn about God. And every Sunday, our minister talks about a certain scripture lesson and expands on it for our knowledge and wisdom and understanding. But every Sunday, we also learn about the Bible in other ways. What's another way where we learn about all the people in the Bible, not just God and Jesus? Do any of y'all go to Sunday school? I think we're lost here. Well, I want to show you what this church has done in 75 years. And I'm going to ask the congregation, if you've ever attended Sunday school at First Christian Church, would you please stand? That is a lot of teaching and learning, isn't it? Thank you very much. Please be seated. Another reason we're celebrating is because Christians like to get together to rejoice, to celebrate. And I'm going to give you a couple other ways that we celebrate. And I'm going to ask the congregation again. If you were married in First Christian Church of Midwest City, would you please stand? We've had a lot of celebrating around here, haven't we? Hope you all know where this is going next. Another way that we celebrate is when we have babies and we dedicate them to church. In church, to the service of God, we promise that we're going to raise them right and help them become Christians like their parents. Now, if you've had a child at First Christian Church and dedicated him in this church, would you please stand? Congratulations. Give all these people a big hand. All right. The next reason I think we're celebrating is due to our heritage or history of the church. Do you know what a generation is?
What is it? It's an entire lifetime of people.
Somewhat, yeah. It's like, and we're going to demonstrate this right now. If you've had three generations or more in First Christian Church, would you please stand? Okay. If you've had four or more generations in First Christian Church, would you remain standing? Okay. If you've had five generations in First Christian Church of Midwest City, would you remain standing?
Well, the last thing I wanted to cover with you is an anniversary of
All right. Now, I want you to do something special. I gave you all $100,000 for you. Now, I want to give you one to go share with somebody in the congregation. Can you all do that?
Yeah.
All right. I'm going to give you one. Go give that to somebody and come back. Go give that to somebody and come back.
Thank you.
others have serious ones. I pray you will be with them and heal them, Father. You are the great physician. I believe in your power to heal and comfort us. Lord, please give peace to those who are in the midst of serious health issues, including those who are suffering and ones who provide care. Ease their worries, comfort their fears. I pray they turn to you and know that you are right there beside them in their time of this crisis. May your will be done in their lives this day. And now hear us, O Lord, as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven,
today. It comes from Genesis 28:10-19, and that's on page 23 in your Bible, if you'd like to follow along. Jacob left Beersheba and went toward Haran. He came to a certain place and stayed there for the night, because the sun had set. Taking one of his stones out of the place, he put it under his head and lay down in that place. And he dreamed that there was a ladder set up on the earth, the top of it reaching to heaven, and the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. And the Lord stood beside him and said, I am the Lord, the God of Abraham, your father, and the God of Isaac. The land on which you lie I will give to you and to your offspring. And your offspring shall be like the dust of the earth, and you shall spread abroad to the west and to the east and to the north and to the south. And all the families of the earth shall be blessed in you and in your offspring. Know that I am with you, and I will keep you wherever you go, and will bring you back to this land, for I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. Then Jacob woke from his sleep and said, surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know it. And he was afraid and said, how awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God. And this is the gate of heaven. So Jacob rose early in the morning and took the stone that he had put under his head and set it up for a pillar and poured oil on top of it. He called that place Beit El. Would you pray with me? Gracious God, on this morning we come to this place, this sacred place that you have provided for us, and we give thanks. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Greetings. My name is Gary Mitchell, and I serve here at First Christian Church in Midwest City from 1991 to 2002 as the youth director, the student associate, and the associate pastor in those times. Can you believe it has been 25 years since we gathered for this kind of a celebration? 25 years, and you probably have asked yourself, where have those years gone? I know I look a little older, and I haven't seen anybody here that does. It's amazing how people in this congregation haven't changed. But it is so good to be back with you. Nancy and I have been looking forward to this, and we seem to have a family reunion going on here today. Isn't it amazing? Congratulations on this occasion of the 75th anniversary of First Christian Church in Midwest City. I remember that 50th celebration, and just like that celebration, we came up here late last night, and there were people working over in the activity center to make sure things were prepared. If I'm remembering correctly, there were a large group of people that were here on that day 50 years ago, and they were here well past midnight as well. So it is something that doesn't change. We live for these moments, and we thank you all for who have planned and have been a part of the preparation for this event. I thank you so much for the honor of being here today. And remember that 50th anniversary celebration? It doesn't seem like it was that long ago. And one of the things I remember in that is there was this big event that happened at the high school. It was a dinner. And in that dinner, there was entertainment. And some of it was more entertaining than others, as I recall. But I remember back in those days, we had a treasurer, and it was Pauline. So we had to come up with some interesting things to do for that entertainment. So a group of people got together and planned out the entertainment part of that. And I still remember it. It's etched in my mind today, that little song that we came up with. You might remember it too, some of you. You say evenator, I say evenator. As long as the bills are paid, what does it matter? And so they came out to this table that's been swim goggles and a swim plug for their noses, and to the tune of the Danube, Blue Danube Waltz. They showed us how the proper way to serve communion, complete with a major crash of the two lids of the communion at the apex of the piece. So things like that remain next in your mind, if you know what I mean. Those kind of things. I don't remember what we were served for the meal that day, but I remember the warmth and the love and the care and the laughter that was shared, much like we will have today as well. We are here. We're here 25 years later, gathering today in a different space than we did in those days, but still focused on God's call to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ to a hurting world. That is our call still today, to create a house of God where God's people gather to worship and then move into the world to share that good news with others. We're in different locations. Does it feel good to be here today? It does. They help, those anniversary celebrations that we have are great, and these times are wonderful. They help us recall the connection and the ministry that we have done together over all of these years. Just think of all the worship, the fellowship, the education, the activities, the other church stuff that has gone on just because a group of people decided to get together 75 years ago and proclaim God's love in Midwest City, Oklahoma. Just think of the massive amount of lessons, as Bill told us, all those lessons that were learned here throughout the years. I'm sorry I didn't bring candy for everybody. I didn't get candy in Bill's children's message today. But there have been some major learnings that have happened here. Serious adult Sunday school classes, vacation Bible schools, kids Sunday school opportunities. Think of all of those people who learned about the Bible and life in the presence of God at First Christian Church in Midwest City. I know one of those things has to be true, and it has to be the kid of one of you in this section. A young girl opened the big family Bible. You know what I'm talking about, the big family Bible that people have in their homes. She was fascinated as she fingered through those old pages, and suddenly something fell out of the Bible. She picked up an object and she looked at it for a bit. What she saw was an old leaf that had been pressed between the pages of the old family Bible. "Mama, look what I found," she says. Mom says, "What have you got there, dear?" And she says, with astonishment in her voice, she said, "I think it's Adam's underwear." Jacob and Rebekah had stolen Jacob's brotherly blessing, and Esau as you can imagine, was not happy. What was to be his, the inheritance of his father's wealth and his property, was now Jacob's wealth and Jacob's property. Ouch. Can you imagine? I know you've never had struggles with any siblings in this place, none of you, I'm sure. But this one is a big one. And Jacob had to go. He had to leave at the urging of his mother, fearing for his life. He took a journey toward his uncle Laban's place for safety from his brother and to seek a wife at the advice of his father, Isaac. On the way, he stops, but at the end of the day, he lays down and uses a rock as a pillow. On the way, he stops, and as he does this, he reflects. He has an encounter with God, and God gives him a reminder of where he comes from. He is descended from Abraham, if you'll remember. His father was Isaac, son of Abraham, and now he, Jacob, was about to be a big deal. Jacob is going to be a big deal. He receives a promise that he would be great. He would be great. He gets this promise, just like Abraham was promised, if you'll recall, he was going to be a great nation. He was going to be made into a great nation. He would receive the land where he was and so much more. And he would have many descendants. Jacob wakes up then, and he proclaims that God was in that space. He could feel it. He knew it. God was there. So he commemorates this experience by proclaiming the place as a holy space. He builds an altar and a pillar of rocks. He pours oil on it, and he consecrates it as the house of God. Literally, in Hebrew, Beit El, or we might say in the English-speaking world, Bethel. Right? You've heard that one, I'm sure. The next section of the story tells us he took a journey. Just right after this, it says, and Jacob went on a journey. And as we know, that journey would lead him to connection and abundance, a new life and a new wife, and eventually reconciliation with his brother Esau. Reconciliation on this journey that he probably never thought would ever happen. He would be led to a wrestling match with God, if you'll remember, and he would survive it. Jacob's journey would lead him back to that pillar where he would build an altar to God and make more improvements on Beit El, or the house of God. He would be called to build that altar there and learn that even though he couldn't stay there, even though he couldn't remain there, he could come back. He could come back to it. He could return. He symbolized that place with a rock and oil, creating a sacred space. Creating a sacred space. Isn't that what church is supposed to do? Create a sacred space. The place that God had come near to him, Jacob did. He was on the run and he had to go. And he had deceived his father and he had deceived his brother. Yet the original hearers of the story would hear about that connection, one that echoed from long, long ago. Go to a new place, Abraham, you'll recall in the story, right? You remember this? Go to a new place, Abraham, and I will make you great. I will be present to you and with your descendants. Another story of God coming near. What are the times that you have felt God coming near to you? What are those times in your life that you have felt God very, very near? About 3 weeks ago, Nancy and I were coming back from our Tuesday evening activity, which is a $5 movie night at our local theater. Any movie for $5, and you get a free little popcorn if you sign up and become a very important person with the card they give you. So we became very important people so that on $5 movie nights, we could get this small bag of free popcorn. It's just perfect. And we have at our church in Lake Ozark, Missouri, Lake Ozark Christian Church, our Lake Area Orchestra practices in our chapel on Tuesday evenings. And every single Tuesday, they leave the light on in the hallway, and it burns precious electricity. And we can't have that in our church. And after trying to get them to turn them off, they still leave them on. So it's become a ritual, $5 movie night, free popcorn, because we're very important people. And then we drive back by the church, and we go, I go in and turn out the lights. It's a ritual. It happens every Tuesday. And I don't think I want to change it now. I think I'm setting in my way on that one. But when we drove up a few weeks back, I noticed there was a body on the concrete by the door of the church. Oh no, it's Kenny again. Kenny had been, last fall, had been sleeping outside our door in the evening time. We have a portico where you can drive a car through, and he had slept there. I came there one evening, and there was a body there. This was last fall, and it turned out to be Kenny. And Kenny, I'm thinking, oh great, he is back. I thought we took care of Kenny's issues about being homeless at the lake. There isn't a whole lot of homelessness that is visible at Lake of the Ozarks. And so I'm thinking, oh no, here we go again. And we found out that I went up and asked, are you okay? I found out that it wasn't Kenny, it was a young man named Brandon. He had come to the lake to stay with his brother. They had gotten into some issues. His brother was using meth, and so he decided he didn't want to be a part of that, so he left. And he didn't have any place to go. And he was planning on sleeping on the playground across the street from the church, but it started to rain. And it was getting cold that night. So, after speaking with him a bit, I called the police, not to have them come and get him or anything, as I told them on their non-emergency number. I called the police just to come and see if he was okay, make sure he wasn't having some issues with drugs or things like that, that he might need more help than I could give him to with. So they came and we talked and all that. So I called the local shelters. They were all full, the two of them that we have there. And I called my go-to motel. We have to put somebody up in a pinch. And they were closed like the inn in Bethlehem. They didn't want to have him there. And so I asked him, where do you want to be? Where are you trying to get to? And he told me, I'm trying to get to Jefferson City, which is 40 miles northeast of the lake. And so I called the Salvation Army shelter there in Jeff City, and they had a spot only because it was raining that night. And they have a special program where it's inclement weather. They will put them on a cot in the hallway just to get them out of the street. And so there, after our $5 movie and our free popcorn, because we are very important people to the people at the movie theater there in Lake Ozark, Missouri, and all that, and turning off the light, Nancy and I at midnight on Tuesday evening going into Wednesday now, drove him up to the Salvation Army shelter in Jeff City. So we were driving back, and I was thinking, as we parted with this simple handshake and a God bless you as he was taken into the shelter, into the intake area. And so I was wondering, as I went home to sleep on my nice, soft pillow that evening, thinking of Brandon, who I woke up when he was sleeping on the concrete, with his head on the concrete under the portico at our church. And I wondered, in that situation, had God come near? Had God come near in that encounter? Was there an opportunity to encounter the Holy there? Was the face of God revealed? Was there an encounter with the Christ? Was there an encounter with Jesus? Had this happening made a difference? Big questions for me. I went home to sleep on that nice, soft pillow, and later came to an understanding that yes, God had come near. The Holy had been encountered. The face of God had been witnessed, and the living Christ had been encountered that night. And that connection, that happening, had made a difference in the world. And it had made a difference, I realized, in my life. And it had made a difference in Nancy's life, too. And I hope Brandon is okay as well. When Chris Miller called and asked me to speak today, I asked him, how long should I speak? And he said, an hour and 10, no more. remembered years of worship and activities and lessons and weddings and funerals and ski trips and mission trips, crop walks and vacation church school, tornadoes and house fires, and a cast of characters. And that, when I thought of cast of characters, one name instantly came up. There were a lot of you that I could count in this category. But I thought about Johnny Gwynn. Help to understand the character of this place where everyone, no matter what, is welcome. I remember that thing. I remember playing softball on this property when it was just an investment that we might build on sometime later, or we might sell to make improvements on the church on Key Boulevard. I remember Easter sunrise service where we projected the worship material, the songs and all of the readings on a big dirt mound over there. Now we went up and put a, is the wood cross still here? That big wood cross that was here? We put this, planted this big wood cross up on that mound of dirt that was probably, I would say, probably about 25 feet tall, so that when the sun came up, it lit that cross as it was coming by with the shroud over the crossbeam, and was blowing in the wind. I remember those times in this new place. I remember that I was finally out of the basement when we moved into this place, into an office where you could actually see the sun if it was shining outside. 6 months later, you sent me off on a journey to be on the regional staff, and I spent that next 10.5 years being very thankful for the ministry I had received and the lessons I had learned in this place. And I've not traveled that journey alone. Just like Jacob, I carry my faith heritage with me. My own life and faith are built on the love and care that I have received here. And it would have been so easy just to share the memories of the day, just to recall all of those things that we have experienced together and that I know about this place. It would have been easy to do that, but there's more to the story than just remembering the stories of our past. We are here to reclaim a future story, one where the experience of the past meets the present and then meets the future, the church of today. And we claim the church of the future, for God comes near in all of our encounters, where we encounter the holy, where God's face is revealed to God's people, where we encounter the living Christ, each and every one of us, and our existence has made a difference. And then we gather at God's gathering space to worship and to sing songs and study and recharge and renew. And we do it over and over again to remind us that we are all on a journey. And the Lord of all creations meets us there on that journey. The Lord of all creation meets us here in this space. 75 years ago, a group of followers of Jesus had a dream to build a place where others would be able to grow in faith and spirit and in love. They stacked up rocks on Key Boulevard, and they consecrated that space. And they journeyed forward and into their daily lives. And they had a space that they could return to, a place where they could share how God had come near to them. Over 50 years later, building on the legacy of those who had come before, a few of the older original church builders and some who had just joined recently along the way made a decision to create a new space for God's people to gather. They stacked up rocks here on this place, and they consecrated it, creating a new space for God's people to gather that is still a witness today to the faithful who have come before and continues to proclaim a message that the people of this hurting world needs to hear. They need to hear those things. God loves you, no matter what, is one of those things. That life lived in Jesus is a life of hope, of peace, of love, and joy. And that life can be abundant, even for those without a penny in their pockets. and that all who follow Christ are welcome here at this table. And we still get the message. We will get it loud and clear. You can't stay here. You can't stay here. Because this is a place that the church gathers and celebrates being church. It's not the church. The church is about to go on a journey. And God is defined in the biblical story in the context of a divine journey. A journey we take alone, or a journey that we can take together. And I can tell you that it's better when you take that journey together, folks. It's better taken together. So take this day and celebrate. Be thankful and remember. But when you leave this space, remember, the church happens where we are. We are the church, and we are the hope for a hurting world. This congregation has a rich tradition of singing a new song to God, just like the song we hopefully still sing that we learned long, long ago. I am the church. You are the church. We are the church together. All who follow Jesus all around the world. Yes, we're the church together. Can we join in that? I am the church. You are the church. We are the church together. All along the
living out of our hearts and minds. We're to give Him the job, the position, the career He called us to at this time in our lives. That we offer to You a small part of that which You've so abundantly blessed us, not the fruits of our labor, but a piece of the harvest, of the daily bread which You allow me to provide us, a bit of the loaves and the fishes, so that we might add to the basket from which You bless and break and share it with the entire world, Your ministry of love to the ends of the earth and at the end of the age. Living more humbly and acknowledging the source and the center of all we are, sharing with others that which was never ours.
started over 2,000 years ago, when your son bled for us, with stripes on his back and nails on the cross. And our joy and rejoicing came when he walked from the crib. It doesn't matter if it's generations or years or mere moments. As long as we walk with you, we are blessed by this one. It's in Jesus' name we pray.
to them in far places, the carpenter shaped with his lathe carved out a community with binding links. God's dreams foremost, love guiding their path. Though habits of worship came from places distinct, they met in a schoolhouse, state officials to guide, made plans to build. From challenging costs, they did not shrink. Early ministers, Bob Nelson, Art Dedamore, helped them decide to faithfully visit the new-built homes all around. Every family uprooted from somewhere else, a tide of unchurched prospects, so new members might abound. Strong bonds of welcoming love were early sown, and compassion for the needs of others found fertile ground. Time brought changes, new dreams to own, more buildings to build, shared heartaches, shared hope. Diversity accepted, loved, matured, and grown. Human, still, perfection is beyond our scope. Our understandings sometimes tossed and turned and torn. Through grace we learned and learn to grasp forgiveness's rope. So on to new challenges, neighborhoods, new missions born. Built on the firm rock of Christ's challenge to love, developing new leaders to teach, guide, and inform. With loving ministers to preach and show the way, inspired from above, with music lifting our hearts and voices raised in praise, with thanks for children's innocence and youth visions raised, we now commit ourselves anew to God's cornerstone, descent of the dove. May God bless the hearing of the word. 75 years of nurturing faith in people of all ages. 75 years of celebrating newborns and weddings and marriages and baptisms and dedications. 75 years of remembering the saints of the congregation and giving thanks to God for their lives of legacy and purpose. This congregation has cultivated generations of faith-filled people whose lives were challenged by the warmth and dedication of a vibrant ministry. Challenged so that they would become dedicated disciples themselves. Well, it's easy to praise the congregation for the work that's done, and I think it's even easier to make a mistake of who truly gets the credit. It's a big temptation because we love to celebrate the good things that we think we have done. But on days like today, maybe especially days like today, we more clearly understand the depth and the breadth and of the divine love that has been and is now and will be forever guiding us and nurturing us forward. It is, after all, the inspiration from God that brings us together. It is the Spirit moving among us now as God's people that fosters a true spiritual curiosity. It is the good news of a Savior that binds our hearts and minds to the life of Christ, our brother and our friend. And so what we discover, it's not just how much God has already been a part of our lives, but how much God will continue to be a part of our lives together so that we may respond in faith. So I invite you to remember or to imagine for the very first time the depth of God's love for you, and in time, respond in faith. Become singing and giving thanks. O God, into this place you have called us today to be an image of your holy people. And from these walls we take a sacred message of hope and love to the world. God, we have offered our praise and our thanksgiving and our songs. We've shared prayers from our hearts, our memories, from the tenderness of our very souls. And we have come celebrating your church and recognizing your faithfulness. So God, we ask that you guide the First Christian Church of Midwest City in your spirit for another 75 years and raise up generations to come to bear witness to the life-changing love and grace. And so send us out, called and prepared and equipped, to love and serve in Jesus' name.